Excel is a wonderfully flexible and powerful tool. For example, you can create models that let you modify your formula's input to estimate sales revenue and cost. You can also model systems that uses random events such as product demand to estimate the resource utilization and other costs. Now, before we get into today's video, where I'll show you how to set up an Excel model which can help you run an effective Monte Carlo simulation to optimize your organization's supply chain and can help you with financial decision making, let's discuss what a Monte Carlo simulation actually is. Monte Carlo simulation is a method of probability analysis done by running several variables through a model to determine the different outcomes. By using Monte Carlo simulations, decision makers can determine the range of possibilities and their probability of occurrence. Monte Carlo simulation works by constructing a mathematical model of the decision under construction. Then the simulation is run and different random variables are put into these models until there are enough outcomes to plot on a probability distribution curve. Based on the shape of the curve created by Monte Carlo simulation, decision makers will know where the ultimate decision falls within the various probabilities. They then make their decision based on the risk they are willing to take to get the outcome they want. Now, let's get to the Excel where I can show you how all of this actually works. So what you see on my screen is divided under three sections: model data, probability of item demand, and simulation data. Let's start with model data. Under model data, I have number of items to be produced, a random number, demand, which is the number of items that public wants to buy, cost per unit, that is the cost to make each unit, then the price for which you are selling the item, and the amount it costs to get rid of the item if no one bought it. Right now, the random number in cell C3 is generated using this formula, and the value in cell C4 is set to 0. The unit cost is $5, unit price is 10, and the disposal cost is 0.5. In the bottom part of model data section, we have revenue, which takes the smaller of the values in C2 and C4. In other words, item produced versus demand. So it takes the smaller of those and multiplies them by the unit price. Basically, that's the money you make from sales. The total production cost in cell C10 is the number of items produced in C2 multiplied by the unit cost in C5. Next, we need to calculate the total disposal cost. This is the amount of money that it costs to get rid of the items that were unsold. If the demand in cell C4 is greater than the items produced, then the disposal cost is 0. Otherwise, we subtract the demands from the items produced and then multiply the result with the unit disposal cost. As we see on the worksheet now, none of the 10,000 items were sold, so we have multiplied 10,000 by 0.5 each to get $5,000. And finally, we have profit or loss, and that is calculated by taking the revenue and subtracting the total production cost and the total disposal cost. Now let's talk about the ways in which you can come up with this probability table. So what you do is basically gather some data from the market to find out what the historical demand of these items were. And after I gathered the data from the past record, this is what it looks like. I found out that out of 200 occasions from the past, market demand of 2500 items were on 20 occasions. Market demand of 6000 items were on 72 occasions. On 70 occasions, we had demand of 10,000 items, and on 38 occasions, demand of 15,000 items. After that, it's easy to find the corresponding probability of these respective items. You divide the frequency of the demand items by the total number of occasions. So the probability of demand of 2500 item becomes 20 in cell J2 divided by 200 in cell J7. I want to keep cell J7 as an absolute reference, so I will press F4 and I will drag down the formula so I can have the probability for the rest of the demand items. The next step is to get the cumulative probability, which is a fairly easy step. For 2500, it's 0.1. For 6000, it's 0.1 plus 0.36. For 10,000, it's 0.35 plus 0.46. For 15,000, it's 0.81 plus 0.19. And finally, we get the random number interval. For 2500 demand of items, we have ranged from 0 to 0.1. For 6,000, it's 0.11 to 0.46. For 10,000, it's 0.47 to 0.81. For 15,000, it's 0.82 to 1. And that's how we come up with the numbers in cell E2 to E5. So what happens is, whenever a new random number is generated, and if that number falls between 0 to 0.1, demand of 2500 items will be considered. For a random number between 0.1 to 0.46, demand of 6,000 items is considered for calculation. And if random number is greater than or equal to 0.82, demand of 15,000 items is considered. Now, the question comes as to how the random number can be linked with this table. And the answer to that is using VLOOKUP formula. So I'll type equal VLOOKUP, and then inside the left parenthesis, I'll type C3. And that's the value that we'll be looking up in the table. Now I need to identify the cell range that contains the data, and that is E2 to F5. And finally, I need to identify the table column that contains the value I want to look up. And that's the second column. So I'll type 2, right parenthesis and enter. So now you can see the random number changed and the rest of the calculations have changed to reflect a new random value. So every time you recalculate by pressing F9, a new random number will be generated, which will change the demand and hence the profit in C12. So the whole point of this exercise is to calculate profit several times, so we can get an accurate number for average profit for this whole process and for different production lines. And how do you do it? That's where data table comes into play. The trick behind convincing Excel to run simulation multiple times is to create a two-input data table. I'll create the data table at the bottom of the worksheet, starting just below cell A15. For this simulation, I want to have 1000 drives per run, so I need to build a data table with 1000 columns. I'll click in cell A17 and type the number 1, and then I'll hover over the lower right corner, hold right click on it, drag down and back up, and release to access this hidden menu here. So click on series, then column, then we are going to increase the value by 1 and stop at 1000. Click OK and it's filled in. Now I need to fill in my row headers for the table. And let's say different production lines available in the market are the ones that produce 2500 items, 10,000 items, 13,000 items, and 15,000 items. Now the goal is to find the profit generated by these production lines and then calculate the average profit of 1000 trials. To do that with data tables, you have to set things up in a very specific way. Step 1 is to lay out the range of values like we did here. Step 2 is to link the formula that we are trying to evaluate. So we'll just take the formula from C12 and reference in B16. And what this is going to allow us is to select the whole range of cells, which includes both the formula and the variety of input values. And from here, we can go to Data tab, What if Analysis, and then Data table. So we don't have any variables in columns. These range of values just represent the number of times the simulation process will be repeated. Our variable values are here in cell C16 to F16. But the value for row input cells are not these numbers here. It's the cell that's actually referenced in the formula that contains the items produced, which in this case is cell C2. And unlike rows, we don't have any variables in columns, so we can just select any blank cell. And that's all we need to create a data table. Press OK and we are good to go. Now that we have used the data to calculate the profit and loss based on the production levels of 2500, 10,000, 13,000 and 15,000 units, the final thing we need to do is to find the average profit or loss for each of the four production levels. To calculate that average for each column of the data table, we'll create formulas in cell C15 through F15. So I'll click in cell C15 to start creating the formula. Type equal average, left bracket, and then select data below it, and type a right parenthesis and press tab. And from there, you can see that average profit is $12,500. Now I'll click cell C15 and drag it over to cell F15, and you can see the average profit for all the different production levels. Now remember, the thing that's driving the simulation is the random number here in cell C3. Which has the formula equal rand. The rand function is volatile. That means that it recalculates its value every time the worksheet recalculates. So now to recalculate the worksheet, I can press F9. Doing so changes the result of the RAND formula in cell C3. And the values in cell C15 through F15 have all changed. As I'm looking at the values in cell C15 through F15, I'm noticing that the production level of 10,000, which is in D16, seems to have consistently generated highest profit. Sometimes it's closer to the other values, but sometimes it's significantly larger, like in this case. So that means, based on the results of this simulation, I would probably want to focus on production level of 10,000 units. Creating an Excel simulation does involve a lot of steps. But once you get the hang of it, it's an extremely powerful tool you'll be able to use over and over throughout your business and operations.